Hey, I'm Zach. I'm a fourth generation dry cleaner and co-owner of Jeeves New York, which is a luxury dry cleaning brand I own with my dad, Jerry, who has 40 years of dry cleaning experience. A lot of you are familiar with our laundry content, specifically our laundry detergent reviews. And a lot of you are curious, how do we get this performance data? So this video is a deep dive into the process, so I hope you learn a thing or two. There's a lot that goes into these tests, and this video may be a bit dense and boring, but I wanted to be as thorough as possible to ensure that you feel that these results are honest and transparent, unbiased, trustworthy, so let's get into it. To begin, this is not just my process, it's the industry standard known as the AISE Laundry Detergent Testing Guidelines version 8, which was updated in April 2023. To oversimplify this test, you stain fabric, measure the color of the stains before, wash it with the product you're testing, measure the color of the stains after, compile and review that data. However, there are an enormous amount of variables that we must control and processes that require an attentive eye, or else your results can quickly become muddled. Here are the specifics of my procedure. First, we gotta have something to stain. So I buy cotton in bulk and have them cut and sewn into 1 foot by 1 foot squares. Most large brands use white t-shirts. However, that drives up the cost as I'd need at least 3 t-shirts per product. Next, the stains. I use 18 different stains that span 5 categories to ensure that all are represented. Those categories are oily, particulate, enzymatic, oxidizable, and special. Some are easy to apply, like foundation. Others are annoying, like topsoil, which requires this clapper device to ensure the fabric stays taut. Also, the AISE guideline states that a minimum of 15 stains need to be tested.
The stains I use by category are oily, automotive lubricant, olive oil with turmeric mixed in, chili oil, and unfiltered red palm oil. Particulate is topsoil, charcoal, red clay, and sand. Enzymatic stains are kale, tomato sauce, pig's blood, and dark chocolate. Oxidizable, mustard, tomato sauce, olive oil, and turmeric. And lastly, special stains like oil-based paint, foundation, waterproof mascara, a matte lipstick, and a glossy lipstick.
The cotton swatches are stained and then left on a drying rack for about a day to make sure they're nice and dry before we test them. That's because if I were to wash them right after testing it, most of the stains would come out completely, and that doesn't help us at all when reviewing a product. Originally, I was drying the stain swatches overnight on a towel, but found that a lot of my oily stains were way lighter than expected. Turns out a lot of those oils were transferring into the towel, so that's why I switched to a drying rack. That took forever to figure out and was quite the headache.
Once dry, the stains' color are measured with a spectrometer before cleaning to ensure they fall in line with my tolerances. I do not do subjective testing, aka use my eyes, as I consider them unreliable. If the swatches fall within my accepted tolerances, they are used for testing. Then the swatches are pinned to a microfiber cloth. I do this because there's nothing worse than opening the machine and finding my swatch as a clumped ball stuck in the door, making the test pretty much useless. I also add a dry cleaning tag to identify the product, wash temp, and date it was tested.
Now it's time to talk about one of the most important steps, including body oil or sebum, since it's the most common stain by mass on our clothes. I'll quote the AISE procedure to show you how important they think it is. Include body soil source, since testing without body soil can lead to seriously misleading results, as body soil has a significant impact on the absolute level of performance and can also impact the relative performance and ranking of products. Why is this so important? Because us humans generate about 40 grams of sebum a day. Sebum is the most common stain on your clothes and is completely unavoidable. Sebum is the cause of body odor and the yellowing of underarms and collars. While my stain swatches are important to measure performance across different stain categories, including artificial sebum is arguably the most important part of testing detergent, as that's what they're designed to remove. Now, it's obviously pretty difficult to get human sebum, so I made my own artificial sebum. To recreate this mixture, I use 1 part jojoba oil, 1 part olive oil, 1/4 part castor oil, and a few drops of squalene? Is that how you pronounce it? I don't really know. But then I end up with this. This solution is the closest thing I can get to sebum, as it's a complex mixture of lipids like triglycerides and wax esters. The AISE guidelines recommends 32 grams of sebum per load, so I basically weigh my bottle before I spray it in and then make sure I lose 32 grams of it. I spray the laundry in the wheel. So I test each product in the same machine using the same normal cycle, and then I do it three times in three different water temperatures, cold, warm, and hot, giving me a ton of data. And I purposely use kind of an obscure mix of clothing in this ballast to kind of recreate the everyday person doing laundry who may not have time to separate their clothes.
As for dosing, I use the same amount of detergent, which is 2 tablespoons or 1 ounce for liquid, or I follow the brand's recommendation if a product doesn't line up with this, like laundry detergent sheets or pods. Once washed, the swatches are air dried and measured the same day, and the results are put into my spreadsheet. Let's talk a bit more about that data. When I measure them, I put them in front of a white sheet of paper to make sure the color is as true as possible. The goal here is to measure the delta E, which uses a fancy equation to quantify a stain's color and measure the difference to see how much of the stain was removed. However, some stains aren't that big in terms of a number. For example, the max delta E on chili oil is 24, but mascara is 60. So, to balance this, the delta E is converted into a percentage and then averaged into a total value for each water temperature.
The final result is an overall percentage of the three water temperatures. We take that percentage and convert it to a 1 to 100 scale to give us a bit more of a range and make it a little bit easier for the audience to understand. So this means that the worst product, which is just water alone, is a 1 out of 100, and the best product is 100, which is Tide Hygienic Pods. In theory, if a product ever did better than the top performing product, all of these numbers would shift. But since it has such a big lead, almost 25 points, I don't foresee that happening anytime soon.
I also file away the swatches alphabetically in case anyone ever wants a receipt.
So then I write that performance number down and add it to the board, but I also take other things into consideration when making my review, like price, ingredient safety, how sustainable is the packaging, because performance isn't just everything. An area that I would also like to test but can't right now is odor and scent removal, because there's no machine to tell me before and after. So it's highly subjective and you gotta use people to do that. To finish this deep dive, here are a few additional thoughts. My goal is to control as many variables as possible to ensure the results are accurate and easy to recreate. But a part of being a good experimental scientist is finding the balance between being paranoid enough at every stage to think of everything and do it right without being so paranoid that you can't trust your result. At some point, you need to say, I did this experiment, this is the result, this is what I think it means. I'm always open to tweaks to my procedure, but overall, I'm pretty happy with how it's working out, considering it's just me and I have a full-time job. One of the biggest things that I cannot control is water hardness, but considering I'm using the same New York City water every single time, I consider that variable pretty well controlled. Something else I do for my own sanity is test just water alone every few weeks to make sure my results are in line, and I'm proud to say I've done about 5 water tests and they all come within about 0.1% of each other. And one other thing I do is run a sanitizing cycle at the end of every week to remove any detergent buildup. The end. Thanks for hearing me out. I hope you find this information helpful.